Apologies for the late start of this panel. I think it's entirely appropriate, though, that we overran on the last panel on dangerous ideas, relevant as it is to the current situation in Malaysia. And it's therefore with some trepidation that I introduce this panel, which takes a step back from the sort of urgent discussion of contemporary Malaysia and tries to situate some of the writers in perhaps a more uncomfortable recognition of what motivates their writing. And so this is among the more literary panels in this very interesting literary festival. I find increasingly that these festivals are more about contemporary issues and events and very often neglect to talk about the writers themselves, which is no bad thing, because I think many of us as writers today are more concerned about the messages and the urgency of the themes with which we write about. So what we're going to try and do today is reflect a little bit on our motivations. The title of this panel is really challenging. It's about the sense of shame and guilt that motivates us as writers. It is, of course, an abiding theme in literature, an abiding motivation in literature from the earliest European writers who dwelt on the aspects of problems in their societies derived from faith, from morality. One thinks of Dostoevsky, one thinks even of Charles Dickens. And then, of course, in the modern age, where these problems became much more urgent in our own societies because we had more freedom to debate them, we see the writer holding up a mirror to society. We see the writer using fiction as a tool of delivering strong messages. And that, of course, has become the norm. We've become so accustomed to that. So, but what I want to explore today and to provide a bit of a background to this, I would like to sort of introduce a subject to our panel today, which has been the contemporary events in the Middle East, the Arab Spring, as we've come to know it since 2011, has produced a whole range of very rich literature in the Arab world that has a very contemporary flair to it, a very contemporary, urgent, discursive look at what's happened to Arab societies. And it is with a great sense of shame that writers like Kamal Daoud, for instance, in the Mosul investigation, I'm thinking of Ahmed Taufik in Egypt in his brilliant dystopian novel, Utopia, have reflected on what's happened in Arab societies. And they started off with this great sense of achievement. The revolution in Egypt, the revolutions that took place in North Africa, the feeling that they were unburdening themselves of the authoritarianism of the past, immediately to become embroiled in internal dissent and a decline into violence. And it is within this very pungent writing that we see in the Arab world that this great sense of shame emerges. So with that, I would like to sort of turn first to Hanne, who's from Norway. And one asks, what on earth is there to be shameful about in Norway?
Who does feel the shame? I think before we kind of start this discussion, I think we should pin down that shame is in each of us. It's a nation cannot be shameful. To be shamed is something that happens inside a body, an individual body. And then and I think also that it is very important to put the notion of shame together with the power, the question of power. Shame, to shame someone is to take power over them or to kind of make them belittle themselves. So I think to talk about shame, I mean, to me, shame is a crucial question. And I think that you cannot deal with a country or a continent and talk about shame like that. It's totally irrelevant and not interesting. We have to free ourselves from our own personal body-wise shame. You feel shame, and what does shame do with you? It cripples you. You look down. It's in your body. How can you... this is not a shameful person. This is a shameful person. How can you take power over this person? And how do we become this person in our own lives? That is what literature is about, I think. And that is one hell of a fight for each of us. And I think the first fight we have to confront in that fight is, what is shame? How do I know that the feeling I have is shame? Because normally, if you are, you know, like intensely shamed, you don't know that you are shameful. That is already a big step to know, oh no, I really feel shame. Because then you can do something about it. But a really shamed person just feels that I am wrong. To be me is wrong. To be the way I am in the world is wrong. That is shame. But you don't know it.
So we go from the shame of the body to the shame of the body politic. Wajahat.
Thank you for that thesis question that you just launched in my direction. I think, you know, Hanne makes an interesting point of connecting shame to power and powerlessness, right? So I can't talk from the Norway perspective, but I think in America, when it comes to shame, oftentimes the conversation always revolves around, I would say, ethnic communities, Asian communities, South Asian communities, Arab communities. Shame is related to honor. An honor-based society where honor is everything, saving face. And if you lose your face, or in South Asia, say if your nose is cut, it means, of course, figuratively, it means you've been shamed. Oftentimes, you're shamed if you marry the wrong person. Sexual improprieties, right? Loss of wealth. You do something, if you will, impious, right? Shamed. It's an act of society, if you will, having control over you and making you feel powerless and bad about yourself, right? I think it's a conversation with society. It goes back and forth. That's a reciprocity. But I'd also say, as an American, this is not just relegated to the Far East or South Asia or Middle East. If you look at shame, it's also very integral to American society. One of the, you know, the key texts is what? Scarlet Letter, Nathaniel Hawthorne, Puritanical. The protagonist has to quite literally wear the A. It's a concept about both guilt and shame, and how shame is used to actually cripple, if you will, women. Also, I would say, you mentioned Dostoevsky, I would say Tolstoy, Anna Karenina. Shame also exists in the European literature. Also, in the British literature, you have novels upon novels of sexually repressed Englishmen who are trying to have sex with other people, and then they have sex, and then they feel guilty and shamed. It also happens, yeah, that's pretty much every English novel of the 17th and 18th century. Someone wants to have sex, they can't have sex, then they have sex, then something bad happens. But I think in the context of the Arab Spring, it's interesting that you see, you know, decades of a body politic, if you will, under colonialism, oppression, imperialism. And the worst part of it is, especially when I say with Muslim civilizations, you once had power and you lost power, right? So what's worse, to never have power, then gain power, or to have power and go century after century after century without having any power? And I think what's interesting, especially right now with Muslim majority societies, and I would also say as an American Muslim after 9/11, is with this, if you will, the shaming that is brought upon us unjustly, or some would say fairly, as caused by ISIS or Al-Qaeda or violent extremists, right? Are you guys still with me? Oftentimes people are saying, oh, look where Muslims were, and look where you are now. You guys once had, past tense, the Ottoman Empire. You guys once had Cordoba. You guys once had pride and masculinity, and your men used to walk with their heads held up high, and your women with their hijab, with elegance, and now look at you, reduced to what? Corruption and Wahhabism and pettiness and, you know, broken down. What is it? Oh, it's something integrally wrong with you. You know, your Musliminess, your Arabness. There's something defective in you as a woman. There's something defective in you as a person who is disabled. There's something defective in you as a person who's black. You should feel intrinsically ashamed of your being as a result of your present state. And I think what we're seeing is a response to it right now, with especially Kamal Daoud. He kind of realizes, okay, I'm a French, I don't know if you guys know him, but French Algerian living in France right now, wrote a book, which is essentially a response to Camus' A Stranger, right? And he writes the, if you will, the Arab-French response, and the narrator is Haroun, the brother of the mysterious Arab, who didn't even have a name, that was killed. And it's a way, I think, of him responding to the sense of shame and guilt. And in a positive way, it's dealing with everything that I just mentioned. How do you process that as a person who once has this proud history, but now is living, if you will, as a second-class citizen, but also as a sense of empowerment, as a sense of I'm going to reclaim my story and my narrative in a way because I've been excised from history, or I refuse to see myself living in the past and being ashamed, I will actually pick up the pen and at least claim some honor that was once lost. I hope that made sense.
Yes, and of course, one of the great, and if I do recommend the book, it's one of the finest pieces of literature published in the last couple of years. One of the great scenes in that book is when they kill a Frenchman in a sort of mirror image of Camus' depiction of the killing of the Arab on the beach. He kills a Frenchman in the compound of their house. And then there's that sense of shame because even that killing, at a time of revolution, earns him nothing. In fact, he gets questioned by the police. So it's a very good point that you raise. Now, you situated yourself in America, Hanne, of course, in Norway. Maureen is an interesting, for me, person to speak on this topic because someone who has written as an exile from her own country in another country, about another country, and then as a translator, has translated one of the finest figures in literature in the world today, Orhan Pamuk. So you can look at this from a number of perspectives, and of course situate yourself in Turkey, midway between us here in Asia and Europe.
So on to the question of shame and whether it's in the body, which it is, or whether it's collective and historical, I would say that it's both. The shame I grew up in, the culture of shame I grew up in, was never ever named. I mean, and it was that in Turkey, the loss of empire, the sadness about that, and all of the unsettled scores from the First World War, which led to all continuing tensions amongst between minorities and secular Muslim Turks. And so one of the things that was the, you know, the great relief and revelation of translating Orhan's memoir is that he named, it was the first time I had read anything in Turkish that named this. And so going back to your, you know, you can stand up or you can speak, which I think why writing and often writing fiction and literary memoir allows you to stand up and take the power away from the thoughts or the cultures that are shaming you. And all of the most interesting writing that's coming out of Turkey is owning and then shedding that shame, naming it and saying this is what's made us, what's made me, this is what we share. Going to that very famous chapter of his about Hüzün, which is not something that resides inside an individual, but somehow is in the air. What I realized or came to understand with much greater difficulty, I think it's really hard to name these things sometimes, is the shame I and we feel, as U.S. citizens who grew up in the new imperial age. So I realized very slowly while translating these books and working on a novel of my own about that time, that there, you know, I had been, well, my family had been part of a very, very large global network of of you know, a kind of a peace army, you know, army, not just waging war. We hear about whenever the U.S. goes to war, we hear about Iraq, we hear about Vietnam. But what about the continuous rest of us who are running all of these schools and universities and think tanks and businesses and so on, we had played a really, really powerful part. I'll just begin by talking about Turkey in Cold War, in the Cold War era. And the Americans were not my parents, but were running the government from behind. Our hand was in the 1971 coup, the 1980 coup, and goes on. And it's very, very hard to see, let alone own, because it's a fragmented history. We're coming and going and coming and going, but we're part of something larger. When I finally finished the book about this kind of collective shame, people started coming out of the woodwork, people who grew up as children in the same world, and they started coming to me with their stories. But it was only after I had kind of bumped into this through translation and named it with great difficulty that other people came and said, yes, I too have been trying to do good after the things that I realized that my families were part of.
One of the abiding themes of this festival that I've seen in the last 2 days is, of course, the great fear that people have that religious dogma and propaganda is beginning to cover up for many of the human failings and weaknesses of our history, of the way we conduct ourselves in society, and that somehow religious identity can cover up for all these shameful acts because there are ways in which we must conform our behavior that is dictated by religious dogma. Now, Hanne, you've written about religion from a very personal perspective, about a priest. And I'm wondering if actually there is a way in which we can square that circle, where we can even be shameful about our religious beliefs and the hypocrisy that breeds in society.
I have not written about religion. He's talking about a novel I wrote that's named The Priest. It's an existential novel. I also find I'm not a political writer. I'm an existential writer. I write about things on a different level than all these political questions. And I really feel it's almost like, shame on you, you are not political enough. And I think that's also important to draw into this because what is politics? I think, and it's all, also as a female writer, I often find that people are, you know, like, oh, you're writing so personal. So is that also, is that also something that's shameful? I mean, yes, my books are intensely personal, and I hope they are for my readers too. And I think that is an extreme strong political statement. I think that if you free an individual from shame, and I think that the initial shame, what is it called?
You could call it original shame.
It is. Original shame. Yeah, I think that is actually the feeling, the deep, deep feeling of not being loved. And I think that all kind of other shames are shades or nuances of that not to be loved shame. And I think to unshame that shame is the biggest work we all have to do in our own lives.
You're clutching at your books, though.
Yes, I am. This is the only book I've had in English translation. It's here. I'll talk about this rather than The Priest, the book you mentioned, because nobody will be able to connect to that. But this book I wrote 16 years ago, and it is about a girl who wakes up in the morning on a very special day. It's the day when She's 19, 20 years old. She's living with her mother in Oslo at the fourth floor in a very tiny, small apartment. And she's a student. She's a very ambitious student. And she wakes up in the morning, and this is the morning 2 weeks before she had her first boyfriend. She had sex for the first time, etc. And this day, he has invited her to go to the United States for 6 weeks for a trip in the middle of the study semester. And she hasn't, you know, known whether she should go or not. And this morning, she wakes up, and it's the day for the flight. And she can't open her door. It's locked. So her mother has locked her in. And the novel takes place in that in-locked room, those hours before her mother, you know, comes back and opens the door. Why doesn't she open the window and scream? Why doesn't she, you know, get help? It was before the mobile phones. This was written, you know, 16 years ago. But still, and I think that is also kind of the core of this shame question. Who am I to do something? Am I in a position where I can actually scream out the window? Do I have some kind of power inside to do that act, to open that window? Do I really want to get out? Do I really want to get rid of my shame? Or do I have the strength to be strong?
So the religion question is interesting, because in America, American Muslims, I would say, the ones who self-identify as Muslim, are far more religious than many of their religious counterparts and from like the host countries. So like in Pakistan, whenever I go back, they're like, you guys are so freaking weird in America, yaar. So religious, what's wrong with you guys? And the reason being is, I think when you're an immigrant or son of immigrants, you have to fight that much harder to retain those religious values. Halal food is not just conveniently, like, you know, given to you, right? The mosque space is not there. You have to fight for it. You have to earn it. You have to bleed for it. When that happens, though, there's interesting, is that for an older generation, or I would say even for the religious population, they feel like the center cannot hold. If you increase the tent, it's so fragile that all things will fall apart. So when it comes back to power and religion, their interpretation of religion gives you a very strict guidelines of what is the honorable way of living your life. If a person deviates from that, or God forbid, you know, their nose is cut, it makes not only the individual and the family be shamed, but also you went back to the body politic, right? Something that drives, I think, Asian cultures in particular, and I'll speak as a Pakistani, I'll translate it. You guys probably have this in Malaysia. Our entire existence is driven by this question from birth to death. Lo kya bolenge? Lo kya kahenge? Translation, what will people say? What will people say? I wrote a book, what will people say? I didn't become a doctor, what will people say? I wore a miniskirt, what will people say? They saw my daughter on a date with someone, what will people say? Right? Oh my God, he ate bacon, what will people say? We lost the home, what will people say? Right? And so what you do instead is, your whole life, you live almost a fiction. You live a fiction. You wear a mask, if you will, for the religious community. You wear a mask for yourself. You wear a mask for your non-religious friends, right? And it becomes almost a prison based upon this contract that you think you have with society, where, if God forbid, if you do some actions that go against the grain, lo kya bolenge, what will people say? The end-all, be-all of our existence. And I think with the religion in particular, it's a very easy way. It's not just religion, by the way. You know, you can have cultural norms, you can have political ideologies, but it's a very easy way of saying, God mandated this, you know, behavior to keep you in check. And it's also a negotiation, I think, with power. And I think with Muslims in particular, especially in the West, after these very violent schisms that have happened that have shocked our consciousness, right? Like for us, it's 9/11. The 9/11 generation. You go again to, I think what you were saying is, we're finding power in a strange way of airing our dirty laundry. Because in America, what it says is the following, when it comes to Asian traditions, is everyone makes mistakes and has warts. You hide it, You keep it under wraps. You deep six it in the Pacific Ocean.
Keep it behind locked doors.
Yeah, keep it behind locked doors, always. Who are you to air our dirty laundry? And if you air our dirty laundry, especially as a minority community, what will people say? They already think we're like demons and barbaric, you know, hordes, the orcs from Lord of the Rings. It'll make us actually lose power. But what's happening, and I think I like the point that you made, what Pamuk is doing, is if you name it, this is the key thing, if you are the protagonist of your own narrative, and if you name the warts, if you name the failures, and also the successes and the triumphs, you can still have shame, a sense of sharam, if you will, a sense of honor and dignity, but at the same time, you don't feel that you are paralyzed. You can gain a voice, you can gain movement. It was interesting that she crippled herself at the beginning. By becoming the protagonist of your own narrative, and by being the one who actually names it, you, in a sense, can regain control and power where once there was powerlessness.
Maureen.
Yeah. A long time ago, I read a definition of the difference between shame and guilt, in which the metaphor was...
I'm not getting into guilt because none of us are Catholics.
I'm just saying the difference. And this is a book that comes from the West, so I think it's different in different parts of the world as well. Or it's a bag in which if it's guilt, you have the zipper on the inside, and if it's shame, the zipper is on the outside. But if you write, you somehow always do the impossible. You take that zipper, and you bring it inside, and you're in control of it again. As you were both speaking, and each in different ways, I was thinking of the something I've been involved in as a translator and an activist, and that's the opening up of recognition of the Armenian genocide in 1915, and this is the 100-year anniversary. No, we're doing really well, actually. We're doing really well talking about it openly. This year I've talked about it openly with my friends inside Turkey, outside Turkey, with our Armenian friends as well. So one of the first books to come out in Turkish about the genocide, rising out of this conversation of Armenian and Turkish historians, mostly in the U.S., the name of it is A Shameful Act. And when the author and other activists were trying to open this subject up for discussion in Turkey, the argument was there is honor in owning the dark chapters of your history. There's honor in acknowledging. So they were actually renaming shame, saying that there was an honor in seeing these things and also in doing more than apologize, just grieving together. Now, the other interesting thing about the story when it opens up in Turkey, and I think this is probably reflected in a lot of post-imperial places, which are multi-religious, multi-ethnic, is that there had been a lot of intermarriage, much more intermarriage than was acknowledged. And after the Armenian genocide, there were a lot of women and children who were saved, sometimes genuinely saved, sometimes taken in to families and made into second wives or whatever, with the result that many, 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 many uncounted millions of Turks are part Armenian. And here we come to this question of politics. Yeah, and these people would... who are part Armenian, it's not something, and many of them even knew, or that's something could be spoken outside the house. But it's opened up by feminist oral historians who work from the idea of the personal being political. And the way that they shattered the official story about it never happening was by interviewing a lot of grandchildren and great-grandchildren of the hidden Islamicized Armenians. And I translated one of those books. There were 25 people they interviewed or who gave their, not just their histories, but what they made of it, which was the really interesting part. 23 of them, this was written only a few years ago, 23 of them still had to use assumed names because it was still going to harm their families too much. They could own up themselves and share their lives and their sorrows, but they still didn't want to risk their family's well-being.
You know, the interesting thing about what you just said, Maureen, is that I noticed that Orhan Pamuk, for instance, he first raised this, 10 years ago or thereabouts, in a statement rather than in writing. And to me, the final issue here is the question of the writer making a stand on issues, not so much, and it also relates to something that you said yesterday, Wajahat, which is that, you know, you mentioned it comes to me as a former journalist, that too many people in their writing are spectators, and that taking a stand is something that we see, particularly in the US, with people who are using satire, who are using more trenchant commentary to take a stand on issues, to bring things out and to be open. And I felt somewhat embarrassed yesterday when you said that, because as a former journalist, raised with the notion that you're supposed to be a spectator, that you're not supposed to take a stand. And I noted also when I was recalling some of the writings that I've read from Pamuk, that in his stories, which is intensely complex and personal, that stand isn't necessarily evident. But when he made that stand as a prominent writer and a Turkish figure, it made a difference. And so I guess, and the question to both of you, all of you, is to what extent is it, we don't need to use our writing so much, it's the posturing we make. And it's taking that stand as an activist that makes more of a difference.
I don't agree at all. I'm sorry to jump in before you.
Okay.
Is that okay?
Okay, yeah.
I think, on the contrary, I think, at least the way I am a writer, and I hardly ever take stance because I change my mind. I don't really know. There are so many things I don't know what to think about. I don't know my meaning about a lot of things, and I have the right to not take a stand too. I have the right to change my mind. I know so little. I think every day it's just like I'm amazed by Jesus. Is this it? So I think this kind of listening also, and I can take a stand and, you know, take another one. I think that is also very important, but that was not what I was going to say. I was going to say that one of my favorite Norwegian poems by Eldrid Lunden, a wonderful Norwegian poet. She has written this poem, and of course, this is not a translation, it's just the message. That was my point about literature, is that... today, you might be locked in a word. Tomorrow, you may be able to say it. And then one day, it may be just like a hardly notable passing wind, the same word. And I think that is what literature is about. It's about opening. And it doesn't do that with meanings, with thoughts. It does it with a tone. It does it with the work of the language that reaches into your body and either locks you even more in or opens you up, because finally you can breathe. Finally, there is someone who has said something in a way that makes it possible for you to exist. And it's not, I mean, it can be about everything. It can be, I mean, Kafka wrote about being, you know, an insect. It's wonderful, it's political, and it's extremely existential, and it's freeing you. And that is literature, that specific thing. And it's inside language, it's inside the word. It's not to sit down and think brilliant thoughts. It is inside the hand of that specific language.
Okay, I'm going to, if it's the last thing I ever do, I'm going to convince you that we agree. Okay, see, keep saying we disagree. But the thing is, you did take a stand on the stage. You stood up, which was a very, very good thing to do. And it was very powerful, and I'll never forget it. So you are making a stand. But the other place, the more important place where we agree is, what is literature for? I think that if you are a writer in certain parts of the world, politics finds you. You're really not looking for it. It's just it's the part of you that, if you're part Armenian, it's the part of you that you're not allowed to be. If you have a sex life, it's the sex life you're not allowed to have, because what will people think? So that's not the you know, it's not choosing politics. I don't think any of us would choose to. I would have had a much happier life if I'd never had to make a stand on anything. But it was when it was my friends who were going to prison, I felt that I had to, or whose lives were at risk from hate campaigns. Yeah. So, but one of the important things that when Orhan Pamuk was prosecuted for insulting Turkishness, and then he became an intensely political lightning rod for a few years, and they were twisting his words and putting him in the newspapers and then twisting them again in newspapers in the West. It was very difficult for us to work together, and very difficult for him to work at all, because he was locked inside his stand, if you like. He made a stand, which was not rising out of a debate. It wasn't just his words, but suddenly he couldn't say anything, and he lost the privacy of his own imagination. So there's an important, one of the things that he said when he won the Nobel Prize, or that was said, taken from another Nobel Prize winner, is the right not to write about politics. Because when you are writing about politics, as a particularly as a novelist, you are keenly aware that you're speaking for, you know, representing a group, whereas the truth in literature lies inside, you know, being able to lock yourself inside the room where you can play.
Help me out here, Wajahat.
So go ahead.
Can I just want a short comment. And I think also what we haven't really talked about in this panel is also the shame in writing. I mean, the shame itself, like you said, Pamuk, the shame to write. I mean, I think also when I do, you know, sometimes I have, you know, workshops with people in writing, and also in my own writing, one of the biggest kind of challenges is to overcome your own shame in the writing. I mean, the shame of, you know, this
what you're writing about, or the shame of the act?
Both.
So I wish I could live in a world where I could be brown, neutral Switzerland. But Maureen made a point that sometimes politics finds you. And before opening my mouth, due to my skin color and my name, my identity is already politicized. And I would even say saying that you're not political is in fact a political act without you realizing it. And, you know, and when it comes to guilt, I think we can tie guilt to it. You know, I'm South Asian, so we're like the guiltiest people of all time. Like, we feel guilty for feeling guilty. Like, we apologize for apologizing. That's like where I come from. But for me, in this day and age, you know, living in extraordinary circumstances, where oftentimes I feel like my peoples, as Americans, as South Asians, as Muslims, living in the globe, if you will, collective humanity, I see so many problems, I see so much misunderstanding, that I see this valuable role for men and women who have the power and privilege to pick up a pen and write, and more so those who us are lucky where people actually read our writings. And I've seen the power to shape, I hope in a positive way, perceptions and minds, right? Because culture, whether people believe it or not, is how we shape and reshape our perceptions of the other, of ourselves, of our identity, of our histories, of our past, of our present, our future, right? Culture is a fantastic, powerful, influential medium for us to quite literally shape the consciousness, which also then, if you think about it, shapes domestic policy and also foreign policy. And so here I am as this Muslim, multi-hyphenated American, living in, you know, 2015 America, where I'm supposedly supposed to be living in shame for being a open Muslim, right? Or being ashamed when I go to Muslim majority countries for being an American. They always ask me, you know, why did you drone us? I'm like, I haven't droned anyone. Like, why did you vote for George W. Bush? I'm like, I didn't even vote for him once. It's a fascinating existence that I have right now where, you know, I'm constantly asked to define what is Islam and what is the West. And I'm asking myself, who is Islam and who is the West? And how come I've never met either of them?
But do you find yourself veering towards the polarization and all that? Or do you somehow want to rise above it and say, you know, actually it's about ourselves. It's about something more universal.
It goes back to the original point that you were making, is once you're confronted with powerlessness or shame or a feeling of failure or dejection, anger, frustration, you can choose to recoil inside, right? Completely abandon whatever those identity markers are that make society shame you or that makes you feel guilt, whether earned or not. Or what I've been seeing, and which I think is very powerful and important in my point of view, is to pick up the pen and actually call it out. Call out those shameful acts, call out the air their dirty laundry, and also air out the triumphs and the beauty and the successes, right? You, not everything has to be about national security. Sometimes I can write a poem about biryani. Why not? I have the power to do that. Like, why do I, as a Muslim artist, always have to write about, you know, race and national surveillance and the profiling and Donald Trump? Maybe I just want to write about my bike. I had a bike once. I liked that bike. It was a good bike. But, you know, we live in a certain time right now where, honestly, if we're going to be very blunt and honest, is I don't have, I think, right now, personally, the luxury just to write about my bike. I feel compelled to write about these other issues, and I find power in these issues. And I find, and this is why I do it, I don't only want to empower myself, I want to empower my communities. And I want to, you know, honestly, sometimes people, maybe it's the same in Malaysia, when it comes to writing, you said that the act of writing itself sometimes is shameful. I said this yesterday. Why aren't you a doctor? Why aren't you an engineer? Why aren't you a businessman? Why don't you do something useful? Why are you bringing shame on the family by becoming a poet or writer? And when it comes to this mindset, sometimes it's not enough to have faith. People need to see faith attached to something successful. They need something tangible. So my existence and my being as a writer, to be honest, with that multi-hyphenated identity coming from these communities, sitting on a stage in Penang, when I post it on Facebook, there's these young kids who, growing up in America, right, feel ashamed sometimes for having these talents, feel ashamed for not being white, feel ashamed for being Muslim, say, oh, if Wajahat could pull it off, maybe I could pull it off. If Wajahat is being validated, maybe I'll be validated. If Wajahat is talking about our triumphs and our failures and our successes and our warts and our dirty laundry, maybe I too can spin my narrative that way and find power and find dignity and find honor where once there was only shame.
Okay.
I have something to say, which I agree with what you're saying, but there's a problem in having that, arriving at that position, because the place where writing begins is in uncertainty, is in that sense of play, writing about your bike. And so having to figure out how to be the public person, the person who's opening up subjects and giving power and encouragement to other people, but also keeping the writing itself going. The most difficult thing when I'm teaching writing is to encourage my students to play, to write against their beliefs, to be irreverent and thereby to open things up. And I always think of James Baldwin, who, you know, incredibly wonderful, rich writer, who then becomes the representative of the American Civil Rights Movement. And at a certain moment, he has to leave. He goes to live in France and also in Istanbul, just not to put the movement behind him, because he still wrote about it, but simply to have the world in which he could live and play and think and imagine and therefore give as a writer. You know, it's the amateur in writing, in the writer's world, that ends up being the most important, the person who's saying, what about this? Yes, there's this expert opinion in that one and this political position, but I'm going to ask the difficult little question.
Shall we invite the audience into this intensely personal conversation? Yes.
Hello, I'm Wan Azring. I'm a Malaysian writer. Since we're talking about shame, I noticed that there are many writers in the 21st century that are becoming very unshameful about their life, because they're bringing their personal life into their writing. You know, for example, in Norway, you have Karl Ove Knausgård, who is writing completely all about his life, his personal life, in 6 volumes. So he writes a lot about shame, his shame as a husband, as a writer, as a man. And so my question is, when as a writer, should we be completely honest about who we are, or should we turn our life into fiction? Because for me, I see that there are many writers today that are just writing completely honest about who they are, you know, and not turning it into fiction. Yeah, thank you.
It's a nice question. Maureen.
First of all, I would question or urge you to question the word should, because that's it's an important thing, but it can also close things down. And then also interrogate the idea of honest. You know, what is honest? Honest about what? If I or somebody I'm reading or a student can be truthful about one thing, that's much more important to me than just being honest about whatever is, you know, going on in their mind.
Yeah, I totally agree with Maureen, and
good.
I think that literature has, at least for me, it has to do with truth, a felt truth, that it has to feel true. And that's on very many levels. And whenever that's working, that's the core, at least for me.
I want to echo the point. I think it's very dangerous when you tell writers and artists what they should be and what they should not be, and you put parameters around them. I find oftentimes you produce really bad art and writing when that happens. And I can take it from an American Muslim context when they say that the only useful, sometimes in our communities, they say the only useful Muslim artist is that artist who produces Islamic art without defining what is Islamic. And then you see these artists who are so talented who sometimes want to write about the bike, but then make it into a Muslim bike. And you're like, and you know, I'm just giving an example. Or then they do these corny, lame, hackney-eyed, you know, this art that is just so encumbered. You could feel you're so closed. So what should an art do? I don't think, you know, I try to be, when I spoke very personally on the stage, it was exactly that, very personal, that's my opinion. I think you should just be good. Try to be good. That's what I always tell people, like, try to be good, and even if you're bad, that's okay, but just try to be as good as you can, and try to make it interesting, so when I read your work, whether it's fiction or not, it resonates with me. And whether or not you should be truthful, I mean, that's for you to say. Like, no, how absolutely. Many of us are truthful in life? We all wear many masks. Just make your mask interesting.
Another question, please.
Yes, I'm actually interested in the question of the necessity of shame for actual wrongs as a catalyst for accountability. And I'm talking about such things as mass atrocity, colonialism, racism. I'm from Cambodia. My family went through the 4 years of the Khmer Rouge regime. And what I feel is sometime necessary in Cambodia is a thoughtful reflection of the shameful things that we did as a people during those 4 years and how that can really be a stepping stone for accountability for what happened. If each of you can comment on that. I think Maureen, you touched a little bit on that in Turkish. In Turkey.
Thank you. Maureen, I think Maureen, start.
I do think that it is a stepping stone to accountability, or actually making things visible, yeah? And which accountability has a moral sort of tinge to it, whereas making something visible in its ugliness, in its beauty, in its power, in its lack of power, so that then you can say, oh, I mean, I think when I was writing that book about the Cold War in Turkey, I looked at a certain point, I saw it for the first time myself. It's not that just that I'm making other people see it, I'm seeing it at first. I said, oh, I grew up in a thriller. I didn't realize that. Because all of these things were going around just around where I was living, and then seeing it, then I can start thinking and asking questions about it. And if you make it visible, to other people, you can provide that same possibility.
But let me just press you on that, because you mentioned earlier, I mean, accountability is sometimes seen as needing a process that has an outcome. Whereas what you were saying earlier was that actually just naming.
Well, accountability is something, I think you said opens up for accountability. And so that's something that you give that you give to the world. But since shame has so much to do with sexual politics as well, I think every time as a feminist writer, I go back to the beginning of second wave feminism and read about the accounts of people opening that up. You know, they were things that, you know, nobody could really talk about sexual abuse in the home. You know, it wasn't visible. When I was at university, we would just say, "Oh, don't go into that, that professor's office, because he'll pinch your bum and he'll chase you around the desk." We had no way of defining that as a public issue, and it was the writers who made it visible that made it possible for society to think about what they saw.
Shaming, I mean, so what you're saying right now is interesting times we live in, because there's a call for transparency, right? And also we have social media. There's this fantastic book written by Joe Ronson called So You've Been Shamed. I recommend everyone read it who has a digital footprint in the 21st century. And shame then, you know, I don't necessarily think shame is bad, because when shaming is used as a tool for accountability, for airing grievances, right? Maybe in the age of social media, one of that female student could have said, "Beware of pervert, you know, professor," and like done a social media campaign. But there's also, I think, everything in moderation, because what we've also seen with modern day shaming, I'll give you an example, Cecil the Lion. You guys remember hashtag Cecil the Lion? It was huge hashtag. There was this American hunter, a dentist, and he, you know, went to Africa, and apparently he thought he had the legal hunting permit, and he kills this endangered lion, beloved lion named Cecil. By the time he lands back, all of a sudden, hashtag Cecil the Lion is the number one trending hashtag, right? What happens as a result? People show up at his dentist office, they smear paint over it, there's extra security, he goes in hiding, his family goes in hiding. The good news is you get like record number of donations to, you know, save endangered animals. Jimmy Kimmel, a late night talk show host, does a campaign. You get both the good and the bad, right? And what they were saying with shaming as a tool in the book specifically is, in America, in the 17th and 18th century, when they used to want to punish someone, right, for doing something bad, for holding them accountable, they used to bring them out in the center of the public life and put them in the stocks. And for basically an entire day, everyone in the community would be like, "Look at that person who did this wrong deed, shame on them." It was seen as capital punishment and torture and phased out of American life by 1830s. Now, if you look at social media now, if you just use some examples, I gave the Cecil the Lion example, we kind of don't really have a temperance as a 21st century society. We're still trying to figure out how to use our digital footprint wisely. I don't think there's really moderation when it comes to shaming. It could be both good in the sense that, oh, look, we found out about the drone campaign, you know, Snowden, the leaks, right? Chelsea Manning, we found out what the US government was doing. You kind of shame the body politics, you shame the government comes out, you know, blames, of course, Snowden, but sometimes you actually encounter some accountability. But at the same time, I'm just using both examples. Sometimes it could be used as a vehicle to speak truth to power and bring about accountability that otherwise they would not have said otherwise, right? Because even, I'll give you a benign example. Hillary Clinton, all of a sudden, is for gay marriage. You guys remember what was happening in 2004? All these politicians were not for gay marriage. So now, once in a while, when it comes to some satire, they're like, "Oh yeah, you're for equality. Look what happened in 2004. Slight shaming, just to embarrass them a bit, right? And that could be a movement towards, you know, more justice, more equality, more accountability, you know, airing the dirty laundry, if you will. But what happens when we kind of go too far? When do we throw in the white towel, and when do we say enough is enough? And I just wanted to explore this right now, because in 2015, 2016 America, I think we as a global society are still trying to figure out, you know, if there's a discipline here of to shaming, and to shaming well.
We have time for one more question. Oh, can you just hold on? Just hold on.
I don't know. Sorry. Yeah, okay.
One more question. Oh, 5 minutes. Yes, one more question. Go ahead.
Having spent a lot of time in this part of the world, I've noticed that political leaders especially seem to lack a sense of shame. And no matter how, and I'm talking about Thailand now, certainly Pol Pot, and I could name another one. There is that kind of individual who does not react to shame. And that often has social consequences and political consequences and economic consequences and moral consequences in the body politic. So I wonder if you could talk, especially Maureen perhaps, about this kind of shamelessness, which it seems to me is extremely dangerous and very current in the world. I live in Thailand a lot of the time. And now we have a generalissimo there, and a whole class of people, I might add, and I think this is true in Malaysia as well, who are beyond shame.
There's a book that I will recommend to you all, which is Dictators' Houses, and it's taking authoritarian figures from, you have it? Okay, from the past century. And looking at the places where they live. And the strange thing is that they all look like they were built by Mussolini, yeah? And so I think those people are actually, they are terrified of shame. And so they go and build these palaces
walls
for themselves so that they can't get, so that they have so many marble walls and courtiers between them and what they're doing. And then when you see them feeling publicly shamed, it's when Erdogan gets insulted by Putin, yeah? And then they have to down a few jets and so on, yeah? So I think that they that the problem is that we can't reach them, is my view, but.
I just, since we're finishing, I thought I would say something that's, you know, I think that the most political thing we can do here now, today, with this shame issue, is that each of us in this room, each of you, each of us, I think, should kind of, you know, go inwards, like we do when we read. I guess that's why we read. And ask yourself and ourselves, what is my shamed? What is the word for my shame? I mean, what is shaming me? What is my forbidden word? What can I not do or say? I think that that's kind of my political wish for this session. I don't have any beautiful opinions to give.
That was a beautiful opinion.
That was. Thank you.
My last comment is that was a very astute observation you made about shamelessness of politicians. And I don't think you have to relegate it to South Asia or Far East Asia. Just look at the United States of America right now. We talked about Sheikh Donald Trump yesterday. And a reason why he's being so successful right now is the utter shamelessness of his commentary. And specifically, he's preying upon this anger of a population that says, we had to feel shame for these politically incorrect opinions we had about immigration, about women, about religion, about Muslims. No, he's saying all the stuff with a bravado and confidence and no shame that we've always wanted to say. And they're writing it. So now he's become like this in a perfect world, he'd be a cartoon character that you'd kind of laugh at, but he is the leading Republican presidential candidate that is actually writing shamelessness, maybe, hopefully not to the White House, but at least probably to the Republican primary ticket. And it's something that I just wanted to let people know is not just something unique to Far East Asia and South Asia. Unfortunately, we're witnessing the poison fruits of the other extreme in America right now.
Maureen.
It's just one that thing I wanted to say before in response to our conversation, which I've completely forgotten now. No, I remember. No. Social media, thank you. We have, in social media, it's all about timeliness. I mean, what we've lost with social media, we make things visible, but it's an event that's just happened right then and people respond to it. it sometimes has huge unintended consequences, but then it's over and we move on to the next thing. And it's why I think that literature, you know, poetry, literary nonfiction, normal nonfiction, journalism, thoughtful journalism, the long story, and novels, we can look more at what one historian called la longue durée. It's those larger stories that never quite get picked up by the daily news. And to make those larger patterns, those slower, more important to our lives patterns visible so that we can think about them. And one of the good things about writing is that you really do have to spend a lot of time on it and think about it before you give it to people. And hopefully people who read it or hear it can give it some thought quietly before hashtagging, yeah?
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you for reminding me.
Thank you for some great contributions to a debate. I mean, I would say that it's not just shameless politicians, it's shameless societies. I think in the last 2 days we've covered a lot of ground in terms of a collective sense of concern we have about not just the figures who lead our societies, but us ourselves. And I just feel very strongly that Hannah's point about the girl in the locked room and the locked door takes it back to that very personal sense. So I feel that we started off with a bit of an argument, but we've ended up with a consensus. So thank you. Oh, no, we haven't. No.
I don't think we have to closure with consensus. I think it's good to just leave things open and
no, we don't have
and go
to.
Out in conflict. That's good. Can I guess we're done, but could I just say a little thing? Because I was sitting here and thinking that, and I was all these things that I've been saying about the body and love, and I'm also a body work practitioner. So it's very interesting where shame is really placed in the body. You know, the female body, this bone here is called the bone. In Norwegian, it's called the bone of shame. Is it like that in English too?
No.
No?
that's a whole other...
But the interesting thing is that love, shame, and sexuality, they are really kind of, they are centered around the sex in the body. When you really feel ashamed, it starts here. That's where you, you know, cripple yourself from. So I really kind of, and that's so deep. That's kind of, I've been running these days here in Penang and over by the park near the sea over there. There's this poster, a yoga poster, giving, you know, different levels for, you know, the yoga points in the body. And the ground level is, of course, the bottom of the sex. And that is the level for wisdom. And this is the level for silence. So I just wanted to give that back to Penang.
I don't think we can. Thank you very much, Hanne. We've run out of time. Thank you all for being a very good audience.